Now we will see General Clauses Act. General Clauses Act 1897. There was an act of General Clauses 1868, then 1887. The last one is 1897. It has crossed more than 100 years. What is the purpose of this act? This act defines something, some words, or give common rules for some acts. For example, this act says power to appoint includes power to dismiss. If some other act has that word only, this person has the power to appoint, then according to this general clauses, that appoint includes dismissal also. For example, Transfer of Property Act defines immovable property as immovable property does not include standing crops, timber and grass. It does not mention any other thing. So the definition is not clear. It says this includes these, then what are the other things included? For that we have to refer to the General Clauses Act. The purpose is to assist the other acts, to assist us in understanding the provisions of the other act. That is why it is called a law of laws. There are two reasons for this act. One is the act came because this can shorten the other acts. The other acts need not define everything, need not give elaborate explanation all these things. That all things are included in the General Clauses Act. This is to be used in all other acts. So, shorten the act. Another reason, if there is two acts and it gives two different meanings, we can refer for this. For example, Immovable Property is defined in Registration Act, Immovable Property is defined in Transfer of Property Act and also in General Clauses Act. The General Clauses Act gives the common definition. If the other acts does not have the definition, they have to refer this. This is an external aid for interpretation of statute. The statute or lawmakers makes the statute that courts interpret it. In case of any need, they refer to internally the act, and if they want, they can go externally, like they can refer dictionary, they can refer General Clauses Act. If the courts need something to interpret, then they refer to General Clauses Act. Now we will see the General Clauses Act. Number section 1 says the act may be called as General Clauses Act 1897. Section 2 is repealed. Section 3 gives the definitions. It gives a definition for all important things which may be required for some other act. Subsection 2 of section 3 says an act used with reference to an offense or civil wrong shall include a series of acts, words which refer to acts done and they extend to illegal omissions also. So it's clear, act with reference to an offense means a criminal offense, an offense punishable under a criminal act. Offense or civil wrong, that is an act which affects the civil right of a person. Act includes acts also, or a series of acts, and also acts of omission to act. This is subsection 2. Subsection 3 says affidavit. What is an affidavit? Affidavit shall include affirmation and declaration in the case of persons by law allowed to affirm or declare instead of swearing. That is, instead of swearing in a court, they can declare, they can affirm and declare, that is called affidavit. Then central government shall means the central government, and the government includes the state government also. Subsection 18 deals with a document. A document, this is an important definition. What is a document? Document shall include any matter written, expressed or described upon any substance பை மீன்ஸ் ஆஃப் லெட்டர்ஸ் ஃபிகர்ஸ் ஆர் மார்க்ஸ் ஆர் பை மோர் தேன் ஒன் ஆஃப் தீஸ் மீன்ஸ் விச் இஸ் இன்டென்டட் டு பி யூஸ்ட் ஆர் விச் மே பி யூஸ்ட் ஃபார் த பர்பஸ் ஆஃப் ரெக்கார்டிங் தட் மேட்டர் த்ரீ திங்ஸ் ஒன் இஸ் மேட்டர் ரிட்டர்ன் எக்ஸ்பிரஸ் ஆர் டிஸ்கிரைப் சம்திங் ஆன் எனி சப்ஸ்டன்ஸ் தென் பை மீன்ஸ் ஆஃப் வேர்ட் ஃபிகர் ஆர் மார்க் ஆர் காம்பினேஷன் ஆஃப் ஆர் The purpose is to make it as a record of that event, record of that matter. For example, one person agrees to pay 5,000 rupees to the other person. This is a matter that there is an agreement between these two people. They can enter this in a paper, that is on a substance, by writing, maybe in some other case it may be a drawing also, mark also. The purpose is to record their agreement to be used in future as a record. Another example, in the olden days, when a king goes to the other person and won in a battle, they record it in a stone. They write in a stone that this person went to this country and the victory was with this person, the other person failed in the battle. These all things are written in a stone. By this definition, that can also be taken as a word, record. Why? It is expressed in word. It is on a substance. The purpose is to make it as a record. Use it as a record. That is a document. Document is a matter written, expressed or described upon any substance by writing letters, figures, marks. The purpose is to use it as a record, that is a document. Then subsection 20 says father includes adoptive father. Subsection 23 says government includes central and also state governments. 35 says month means according to the British calendar, that is January, February, March. Then 57 sun includes adoptive sun. Year says means it is a British calendar year. Now section 4. Section 4 deals with the definitions applicable to the act, previous enactments. It says for which enactments, for which are the words which will be applicable to the previous enactments and the subsequent enactments also. This section 4 deals with that. Section 5, coming to the operation of enactment. When the act comes to force, that is, if a date is mentioned on the act will be in force from that date. When the act does not have a date, it will be effective from the date the president signs the act, when the president's approval is obtained. An act will be drafted, placed on the parliament, the parliament debate, after that voting. Once it is voted in favor, then it will go to the president. President will sign. The act will be effective from that date. In the case of state acts, governor will sign the document, signs the act. When the president assent is obtained, it will be effective from that date. Now section 6. Section 6 deals with the effect of repeal. Repeal is deleting that act from the history, making the act ineffective from a particular date. For example, a state may invite the industries to invest in their state by giving concessions. For that concessions, they may make an act. For example, for the next 5 years, from the date of investment, you need not pay income tax, you need not pay sales tax. So they may pass an act, Sales Tax Concession Act. It will be enforced. Based on that, people will be coming and investing in the state, enjoying the tax concession. Subsequently, they may repeal the act. Once it is repealed, what will happen? These people are enjoying some benefits, some privileges based on the act. What will happen? Some people might have been punished for an offense committed under the act. What will happen? That is section 6. What will be the effect of repeal? It says, unless a different intention appears, if there is some other intention that you go by that, if there is no intention appears from the act, the repeal shall not revive anything not in force or existing at the time of which repeal take place. There will not be any fresh thing. What will be there, nothing new. Shall not revive anything. Repeal shall not revive anything. One. Number two, affect the previous operation of any enactment so repealed or anything duly done suffered thereunder. Affect any right, privileges, obligation or liability accrued or acquired or incurred under the enactment repeal. Affect any penalty or forfeiture. Affect any investigation. That is, the repeal shall not revive anything. What was not there yesterday will not be there. You cannot claim anything new. If there is any privileges or rights, then that will continue. In the given example, I already gave you an example that a person was given a concession that you need not pay sales tax for 15 years, sales tax for 5 years. In that case, he will continue to enjoy the privilege, rights given under the earlier act, even though the act is repealed. So the operation of the previous act is valid. It will be continuing for the period already given. If he is given privileges for 5 years, already 2 years over, after that the act is repealed, again for the next 3 years he can continue to enjoy the privileges, rights. If there is any liability on that, he has to satisfy that, he has to go by that. Then if there is any punishment, penalty, forfeiture, that will be valid. For example, if a person has committed an offense under the act, he was punished for 2 years imprisonment, he has to complete the imprisonment period. He cannot say, now the act is not there, why you are putting me in the jail? He has to do that. If he has been punished with a fine, he has to pay that. That is the negative part. The punishment thing should be valid, even though the punishment thing will be valid even though the act is repealed. Next, if there is anything pending, that will continue. Pending investigation, pending legal proceedings under the old act will be continued even though the act is repealed. That is, the position is, the repeal will not affect the rights of the persons. Already they enjoy some privileges, means that will continue. The punishment, they have to continue in the same position. Legal proceedings and investigation will also continue. The repeal will not affect all these things. Next, repeal of act making textual amendment in act or regulation. An act which amended some other act was repealed. What will happen? For example, 1956 Hindu Succession Act gives right to son for the property of the father or mother. This Hindu Succession Act gives only the right to the property only to the son. Family property, daughters were not having right over the family property. So then 2005 there was an amendment which made that which amended the 1956 Act and added daughters also along with the son. Son and daughters were having right over the family property. The purpose of 2005 Act was to amend the 1956 Act. Further, in 2015, another act, that act repealed the Act of 2005. An act, the purpose for which was to amend the 1956 Act, was repealed by 2015 Act. Now, you cannot say that since the 2005 Act, which amended the 1956 has been repealed, all the amendments made in 1956 will be invalid. You cannot say like that. Once it is amended. That is section 6A. Repeal of Act, making textual amendment in an Act or regulation. It will be in operation. Number 7, revival of repealed act. The government, the lawmakers can revive the act which is already repealed. Number 8, construction of references to repealed enactments. Sometimes one act may be repealed and a new enactment may come. Companies Act 1956 is repealed and the new enactment is Companies Act 2013. Some act may have a reference of Companies Act 1956, but now it is not there. In that case, the corresponding provision of Companies Act 2013 has to be taken as a reference. That is section 8. Then section 9. Commencement and termination of time. If it is a from and to, you leave the first day and include the last day. That is the section 9. Then section 10, computation of time. If the time is on a holiday or public holiday or a Sunday, then you go for the next day. For example, a court appeal has to be filed within 6 months. The last date was a public holiday. Court is closed. Then you go for the next day. That is section 10. Section 11, measurement of distance. It says the distance should be measured in a straight line on a horizontal plane. Number 12, duty to be taken on a pro rata basis. If a duty is to be collected, you take it on pro rata. If it is for 1 year this much, for 6 months you take pro rata. If it is for 100 kilo this much is the duty, for 50 then you take on a pro rata. Then section 13, gender and number. Wherever he is there, it includes she also. Wherever it is singular, it take it as plural also. Then section 14, power conferred to be exercisable from time to time. If the power is given, you can exercise it when there is an occasion, wherever the occasion demands, the power can be used. Now we will see the remaining things in the part 2.